Good morning. This is Maria Pavitra from Department of ENC, working as Assistant Professor in Maharaja Institute of Technology, Mysore. So today we know that all of us use one or the other type of electronic gadgets for our day-to-day activity, right? From the mobile phones, what we use, to the laptops and many other electronic gadgets we use in our day-to-day life. Okay, so let us just take an example of a laptop. So we might be having an idea of how the laptop's internal structure would be, right? The laptop means it will be having a battery for sure, right? A battery. And then once we say it is a system, then we will have a processor. Then once we have the processor, we will be having, we know that in our laptops, we have the fan that is there to cool the system, and then some other graphic user interface, GUI cards. As an example of a laptop, we know that we have a battery. Let us say the battery is around the range of 10 to 20 volts, and let us say the processor that we are using may be ranging from 1.2 to 1.8 volts. It varies from different systems that is manufactured by different companies. So in general, right? So GUIs means we are going to use a digital IC, and approximately we can say it may be around 5 volts and so on. Like this, internally we have different devices that are connected together in a one system, and the value of the voltage is also different. Okay, so now when we are using our electronic gadget, now we know that when we are using our laptop, suddenly the battery goes down, right? So what do? Once the battery goes down, we use the main supply, that is the switchboard at our home or working place, and we connect this battery, the laptop, to the main switch. And we all are aware that whatever the power we are receiving in the switch that we use in our domestic appliance or at the workplace is nothing but the AC main supply. So we also know that the voltage what we receive is around 230 volt, and it is, since an AC supply, we use a frequency of 50 hertz, right? Now we are using, once the battery is going to be dipped off, the battery level is going to be going down, we connect it to the supply mains and we are going to charge the battery. Now how this works? So in order to know how the electronic gadgets, whatever we use, is working, we need to study the subject that is known as power electronics. Okay, so now here we are dealing with AC power, and we generally know that battery means it is a DC source, right? So when we are converting from AC to DC, AC is also power and DC is also the power, so we need to know, in general, as a prerequisite to study this subject, we need to know how the electric power is transmitted, is distributed, and it is being generated. Okay, so we should have a prerequisite of how the electric power we are generating at the generating stations, and then we are transmitting the generated electric power to the different distributed stations. It can be for industrial purpose as well as for domestic purpose. Okay, so we should have an idea. So this process, that is the equipments that we are using as a static equipment or a rotating equipment in the transmission, distribution and generation of electric power, deals with the power part. This we have already studied in our lower semesters. Okay, next coming back to the example, we have the battery, we have the laptop in which the battery is being charged by an AC supply. So we have an AC supply, we have to convert it into DC supply. So in order for this action that is to be taking place, the conversion action, we require some of the semiconductor devices. Right? Semiconductor devices we already know. So far we have studied is the diodes and the transistors. Okay, like this we have many more semiconductor devices which helps in the process of conversion of the power, electric power, from one form to another form. Okay, so this conversion of power with the help of the semiconductor devices. Semiconductor devices means it deals with the electronic part of the subject. Okay, so as a prerequisite, we require to understand how the electric power is being generated, distributed and transmitted. Once the electric power is available, either in the form of AC or DC, next is the process of conversion either from one form of energy to another form. So for that, we require the semiconductor devices. For now, we know that diodes and transistors are the semiconductor devices. So using these devices, how we are going to convert the electric power from one form to another form? Okay. Next, whenever we are doing this conversion or whenever we are dealing with the aspects of power, voltage and current, we need to do the measurement, right? Measurement also, in our day-to-day activity, each and everywhere we make use of measurements. Now, for example, let us say we are going to the shop to buy sugar. So we don't just say, give me some sugar. We specifically say that, give me 2 kgs of sugar. That 2 kg is the measurement value. Okay, so how it is being measured? It is by the use of an instrument or a weighing scale. Okay, so in general, in our day-to-day life, when our body gets heated up, what we do? We measure the temperature of our body. So we are using a thermometer. That is an instrument which we make use of either electrical quantities or physical quantities, depending on the different type of measurements that we are using in our day-to-day life. We need the suitable instruments, right? So in order to know what are the different instruments or instrumentation that is available for electronic and as well as for the physical parameters, we also need to study instrumentation. So for this semester, you will be studying power, electronics and instrumentation. So what is the actual process? What we are going to do? We are going to convert. Conversion is the main process. Conversion of one form of energy to another. Coming back to the example here, we have converting AC to DC. One type of conversion. Then we have the next type. We have a battery which is having a 10 volt capacity. Now using this 10 volt battery, what we have to do? We have to supply the processor with only 1.2 volts, right? So what is going to do? Battery voltage is 10 volt, but the processor needs only 1.2 volt. So here also some conversion process, but it is from DC to DC itself. Whereas here it was from AC to DC. So first main thing what we are going to do is conversion. Okay, then conversion of energy from one form to another, and we are also going to achieve the controlling action. Now we know that diodes and transistors are available with us as a semiconductor devices. Now the diodes and transistors switching action. Switching action means how long it remains on, how long it remains off. That on and off period is known as the switching time. So depending on how long you want the device to be in the on state or the off state, you are going to achieve the controlling action. Okay, so conversion and control. So the definition of power electronics is nothing but we are going to convert and control electric power from one form to another form by making use of the solid state semiconductor devices. Now coming to the syllabus, first module deals with the introduction and the thyristors. Thyristors are another type of semiconductor devices which we need to know. So in detail we will be discussing about the thyristors. Then comes the module 2, which speaks about the conversion process. That is how we are going to convert from AC to DC, that is the working of a rectifier. Then in the same module we will discuss about the DC to DC conversion, that is also known as the choppers. Next, moving to module 3, we will be discussing about DC to AC conversion, that is also known as inverters. Then SMPS and
Then we will directly go to the principles of measurement. 4 deals with the voltmeters, multimeters and the bridges which we use in our lab. Then module 5 deals with the transducers and few programmable logic controllers. So this is regarding the syllabus that we are going to discuss in this semester. Next, the textbooks that we have to refer is the textbook that is Power Electronics by M.D. Singh and Kanchitani. That will be your main textbook, along with Electronic Instrumentation by Kalsi. Then few more reference textbooks are available which we can have a reference for our syllabus. Next, we will start up with module 1 which deals about the introduction.
We will go to the history of power electronics. So initially around 1900 for the power electronic conversions we were using mercury arc rectifiers. Up to the 1950s we were using metal tank rectifiers. Rectifiers we know in general which converts AC to DC, and only that was the process of conversion. Up to 1950s we were using metal tank rectifiers, then vacuum tube controlled rectifiers, vacuum tube rectifiers, and then we were also using ignitron, thyristron. These were the different devices that we were using in order for converting power. Okay. Later, around 1948, Bell Lab introduced something known as silicon or the semiconductor devices. With the invention of these semiconductor devices, then came into the existence of, in around 1956, there was an existence of a four-layered device known as the PNPN device. It is also known as SCR or the thyristor. Importance of power electronics came into existence, and this gave the power electronic industry continued with the same momentum with the in around 1980s to around 1990s. Okay, the momentum was maintained by making use of the different devices such as BJTs, MOSFETs and IGBTs. With the invention of these devices, there was a boost to the field of power electronics. So this is a brief history of how it started, how the power conversion started, and now how we are going to use with the best available devices from the electronic industry. Power electronic systems. So we know that, let us assume that we are in a room, we are feeling very hot and we want to switch on the ceiling fan. Let us say for example we have turned on the fan and now the fan is rotating at high speed. I want a reduced speed. So what I am going to do? I am going to vary the regulator knob, and hence what happens? The motor which is running automatically decreases its speed. Okay, this is nothing but a system. Now whatever the main supply what we have is the power source, right? We have a motor within the ceiling fan, and to achieve the controlling action for the motor depending on whether it is suiting the desired output. Now if I am feeling too cold after switching on the fan, that is not my desired output, so I will be giving the feedback. My feedback is reduce the speed. That is the command what I am giving to the system. So once I regulate, using the regulator I reduce the speed of the fan. Okay, so this is nothing but a system. Keeping the same example, the power electronic system, the general block diagram is, for a system to exist we require a power source. Then once you have the power source, you need a power modulator. Power modulator. So this power modulator will be connected to the motor. Right? Once it is connected to the motor, it can also be connected to the different type of loads. General system. Now, in order to achieve the controlling action, we have to sense the input. Let us say we have a sensing unit. Now, for the different command, okay, the command what we are going to do, this is the control unit which compares whatever that is being sensed from the output side to what is the command that is being given, and the difference of this will be fed as the control input to the modulator. So this is a general block diagram of a power electronic system. Power source, it can either be an AC source or a DC source, and you can also have a, in AC we have single phase and three phase system with the frequency of 50 Hertz, and DC, depending on which application you are going to use, you can have the suitable battery as the power source, right? Next, coming to the power modulator, this block can function different type of operation. It will control the source that is being, the electric power that is flowing from the power source, it will let into to flow it to the motor. Okay, that is the first operation power modulator will perform. Okay, next one is, it will select the mode of operation. This power modulator selects the mode of operation, like whether you are going to do the motoring operation or you are going to do the braking operation. In later classes, I will explain in detail what is this motoring and braking. Okay, so it will select what type of mode it has to run. Okay, so that functioning also is done by the power modulator. Then the next part is, whenever the power source, that is the power, is moving from the source to the load, okay, it will allow the power to flow or the voltage to flow only from the power source to the load, not in the reverse direction. And during the transient operations means during the start of the motoring, or when you apply the brakes and when you take the speed reversal. So in all these cases, these are the transient periods. So during these conditions, during the starting and during the speed reversal process, this power modulator takes care such that there will not be any reverse current or excessive current flowing back to the source. Okay, so these are the important operations that will be performed by the power modulator. First is, it will only allow source, the power to flow from the source to the load, only one directional. And then the next one is, it will select the mode of operation, whether it has to do the motoring or the braking operation. Next, it will allow only the power that is flowing in one direction. When there is excessive current that will be present at the load or the motor, it will avoid the reversal of the currents. So this operation will be performed by the power modulator. Next, motors. Coming to the motors, we have already studied there are different type of motors. Let us consider DC motors. In DC motors, you have studied shunt DC motors, series DC motors, and compound DC motors. Okay, so that is a combination of shunt and series. So any type of motor can be used. In case of the induction motors, we know that it is a squirrel cage and the slip ring type of motors. Next, coming to the load, load keeps on varying. Now for the lifts or the trolleys, this load plays a major part. Okay, later we'll come back to that. Now, whatever the output we are going to give from the motor to the load, we are going to sense the output. And here, when I am giving the input as a command to the control unit, that is a regulator, then again the operation takes place and we are going to get the output. This is a generalized power electronic system. So like this, for any application, we can make use of power electronic system. We have a variety of applications in power electronic system, starting from our heating purpose, lighting purpose, then for the different motors, speed control of motors, for example the fan, like that, and to vary the intensity of light. Like this, the domestic appliance applications are many. In our day-to-day life, we make use of one or the other type of power electronic system. Similarly, industrial purpose or transmission purpose, HVDC systems or HVAC systems, we make use of the power electronic systems, that is along the transmission lines. and aerospace. Like this, all the fields we make use of a one or the other type of power electronic system which generally performs this operation. Maybe source is varied, load is varied. Like that, the modulation process, some other controlling action can be included. Like this, any type of operation can be included which completes the power electronics system.